So what's the last one?
So what we're going to do in the last step, and I probably shouldn't go through all the grungy details, though. All the pieces that you need for this have been in stuff that I've said. But what we're trying to do now is represent this value function VAZ of T applied to the belief state B. And we said that was going to be basically a dot product of the belief state with some kind of reward vector for the current action, plus a weighted version of the value function for the previous time step. So it's going to be helpful to actually take the value function at the previous time step and write it out more explicitly. So this is basically just expanding on the definition of the state estimator that we did in a previous slide.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to say that the value according to the t minus one time step value function for the belief state that we get from taking action A and making observation Z from belief state B, we can write this out as the maximum over all vectors in that set of the dot product of that vector with the resulting belief state, which we had previously derived to have this form. Okay, the observation function times the transition function times the belief state, and then normalized. And this normalization factor is the probability of making the observation Z given that we're in belief state B and action A. This is a highly nonlinear function, but this is the awesome part, ready? Since we're going to ultimately multiply this value function times the probability that Z is the actual observation, in other words, probability of Z given B, A, this and this end up canceling. And what we're left with is an actual linear transformation. So this weird divide by thing that actually makes things really yucky cancels itself out. So convenient.
Just like life.
Not usually, but math sometimes does this for us. And so at the end of the day, we end up with a quantity that is a dot product with the belief state and another quantity that is a dot product with the belief state. We can factor out the belief state. And what it leaves us with is a giant vector, one for each combination of observation, action, and which gamma is going to be the maximum at that observation. So we actually have to take the product of the number of vectors that was in the t minus one set raised to the number of observations times the number of actions. And that's going to be the maximum size of the set that we get for representing the t-step value function. So like you said, could blow up, but still finite. Can't blow up to be infinite if it started out as finite.
Nice. So that feels like a proof by induction to me.
Great. Okay. And so you wouldn't want to actually do this. there is code in Burlap for doing a lot of these processes. There's also my collaborator Tony Cassandra created a program called PomDPSolve that you can download that actually that does all these calculations carefully and you know on your behalf. So I didn't really want to get this to the point where you could actually necessarily code all this up, just to believe that it's code upable and you know you can use an existing implementation if you want to actually run it.
It's very mathematical of you.
So there's one more step before we can get something that I mean, you can actually implement it this way, but this is guaranteed to be exponential because you're actually combining all these things together. There's one step that we can do that if it's the case that the Q functions have a small representation, then the algorithm will run quickly.
All right.
Here, it could be that the Q functions are actually very, very big. Oh, in case it's not obvious, the Q functions are represented right there.
Oh, yeah.
I called it VA sub T, but that's really the Q function.
I like it.